Coming to you live from the fabulous MediaPlex in downtown Windsor, this is a St. Clair College journalism presentation.
Hi, I'm Sarah Ryrie, and you're watching MediaPlex News Now. Do you know who's tracking your information on the internet and cell phone? Recently, ex-NSA contractor Edward Snowden released classified information leaks, which includes documents on Canadian intelligence agencies. A local tech professional says one of the recent buzzwords around the topic, metadata, is actually a powerful business tool. Rick Dawes takes a look.
The internet is a stream of information that flows in pieces. Some of those chunks are your digital traces. There's a lot of content, and to businesses, it's valuable.
Metadata is all the information relating to the travel of online communications, from the number of the mobile device used, to the length of the conversations, to the amount of calls made that day, to even the keywords used to search on the device. Only the private conversation inside the message itself is not part of the metadata.
I never really heard about it until you told me. Never heard that term before.
Mo Hashim lives downtown and sometimes connects to public Wi-Fi near his home. He's active on Facebook, messaging friends and using search engines, and all of this use creates metadata about his activity, and businesses are tracking that. Windsor IT company AlphaCore says collecting this data from company websites gives businesses a competitive edge.
Well, for us, because we are a business-to-business firm, metadata to us means developing a website that speaks to the type of popular searches that consumers are looking for today on the web through Google, Yahoo, Bing.
Keywords, a type of metadata, help search engines deliver a business's page to their target audience. Popular keywords can change over time, even day to day.
But the person who gets to the right keywords first will typically do better because they've been established in that topic for longer.
But legitimate businesses are not the only ones tracking you and I on the internet. It was revealed in a leaked document last week that Canada's spy agency was sweeping up metadata from a Canadian airport Wi-Fi access point for 2 weeks. With the UN announcing privacy a human right, do you know where your information is going online? Rick Dawes, MediaPlex News.
An environmental issue that was resolved last year could be up for debate with Detroit City Council. Adam Elbaba joins us in the studio with more.
Petroleum coke, or pet coke, is a byproduct from refining tar sands in Alberta. Last year, Windsor on Watch, or WOW, had these piles removed from the riverfront and put into storage facilities. While the Great Lakes Institute for Environmental Research says this product is non-hazardous, WOW thinks differently.
You can see your footprints in it when you walk by.
Windsor on Watch was making noise along the riverfront, hoping their voices would be heard.
When we did this, we connected with all the Detroit people, and we communicated, but making a lot of noise. We didn't get to them today, so we're just going to bang away ourselves, because we're mad.
Established 5 years ago, WOW is a local initiative protecting Windsor's environment, in this case, the pet coke problem.
It's supposed to be stored safely and covered, so that it doesn't affect the people.
Randy Emerson, a member of WOW, says even though our oil comes from Alberta, the repercussions are felt here.
It's coming all across the United States and Canada. So if people in Windsor think and Detroit think that the tar sands is just staying up in Alberta, no, it's here. It's right on the shore.
Above all, WOW's message is clear.
Love your earth. Take care of it. It's yours. I'm leaving.
Detroit City Council is holding a meeting tomorrow, and city officials say Detroit Bulk Storage is welcome to attend and appeal the case. Detroit Bulk Storage has not confirmed whether or not they will attend the meeting.
Now let's check in with weather specialist Sean Garrity. Sean?
Well, Sarah, the ground has said we'll be getting 6 more weeks of winter. By the looks of things, I believe that old rodent is telling the truth. The snow has finally let down in the last 48 hours. And it is minus 10, but it feels like an Arctic igloo. I'll be back a little later on in the show with your full forecast.
Thanks, Sean. Windsor has had no small amount of snow this season, but as Veronica Jurkowski explains, help is on hand.
There's no such thing as too much help. Snow shovels have become a necessity this winter season as the snow continues to pile up. With two hands, a bit of time, and a shovel, it's possible for some residents, like Marietta Costello, to go about their day.
I think people who don't have snow blowers, snow shovels, they're elderly, they're ill. Yeah, shouldn't be shoveling. It'd be nice if they had, you know, neighborhood kids that could do it.
Kids may not be offering their services, but volunteers for the city's Snow Angels program are. The program offers snow removal assistance for the elderly and disabled community. Catherine Mersch, coordinator of Snow Angels, says volunteers were in short supply not long ago, but that's changing.
With those with police clearances in, we only have about 70. But they're helping over 100 residents, so most of them are taking on more than one address, which is great to see.
Police clearances can be a hurdle for both the program and volunteers, as they can take from 1 to 3 weeks to be approved.
We've been working with the Windsor Police Service to try and speed up that process, and they've been really great in helping us out.
The Snow Angels program offers more to its volunteers than the amount of community service hours they can collect.
So we are raffling off an iPad Air as well as 5 full year memberships to the new Adventure Bay Family Water Park.
The Snow Angels are not the only ones clearing the city sidewalks and driveways. Aaron DeMars, a grade 11 student from Herman Secondary High School, says he often lends a helping hand to his neighbors just for fun.
Well, it kind of helps them out a little bit so they can get out of their driveway and go to where they need to go.
His neighbor, Francois Perry, says that he and his wife are truly grateful for the help.
Because of my health conditions, I'm advised not to do no heavy lifting. So we have to rely on others to help us out in that way.
Whether you're part of the city's Snow Angel program or simply an angel to your neighbors, it's nice to know that some people are willing to dig each other out of a heavy situation. For MediaPlex News, I'm Veronica Jurkowski.
Water is the life source for all things, so reporter Taylor Desjardins tells us how hydration is an important part of a healthy lifestyle.
Water is key to our survival. Every cell, tissue, and organ relies on water to function properly. It is used to maintain the body's temperature, remove toxins, and lubricate your joints. As we lose this water, we need to replace it with more. You may be thinking, well, how much water should I be drinking per day? It all depends on the person. The healthier you are, the more you're able to drink alternatives to water when you feel thirsty. If you are sick, an old adult, or have medical conditions such as kidney stones or bladder infections, you may need to increase the amount of water you consume. For the average person, they should drink 6 to 8 8-ounce glasses of water daily. There are symptoms of dehydration, but you should not wait until you see these symptoms to drink any water. These symptoms are sleepiness, little to no urine, dry mouth, no tears when you cry, extreme thirst, dizziness, and headaches. Here are some tips to keep hydrated. Keep a bottle of water with you at all times. Fill it up at fountains throughout the day. If you don't like plain water, add a lemon or lime to it. Drink before and after any physical activity. Make a schedule for when you will consume water to ensure you do it each day. Now that you understand the benefits of water, I hope you add more water into your diet. I'm Tila Desjardins, and this has been your Health Minute.
50 years ago, the Beatles asked America to hold their hand. America couldn't say no. Last Friday marked the 50th anniversary of the Beatles' arrival in the U.S. Nielsen estimates more than 73 million people watched the Beatles' first appearance on The Ed Sullivan Show. The following Sunday marking it one of the highest-rated non-sports program in the history of television. Tomorrow will mark the 50th anniversary of the Beatles' first U.S. concert at Washington Coliseum. Well-known actress Shirley Temple died yesterday at the age of 85. Temple was known for being a Hollywood child star in the 1930s and 40s. She starred in classics including The Little Princess and Heidi. After retiring from the industry at 22, Temple raised a family and later became active in politics. Temple has long been considered a bright star in the age of economic depression. This winter, there has been no lack of snow and ice, except maybe at Charles Clark Square. Dana Poisson tells us more.
An innovative approach to traditional ice skating will soon be available in downtown Windsor's Charles Clark Square. The City of Windsor installed synthetic ice at the square early last week, but it has not been announced open. The $57,000 project will cover the 70 by 90 foot area. John Michelli, Executive Director of Parks and Facilities, said that the synthetic ice means the city will be able to offer more consistent skating.
The one good thing is for the community, we're going to be able to offer consistent ice skating. Some of the challenges that we've had in the traditional ice surface down on Charles Clark Square has been because of the warm weather, the usual warm weather that we've had in Windsor. This year has been a very unusual type of winter that we've had here. We've lost approximately one third of the ice time down at Charles Clark Square. We usually have it opened up for around 90 days. Last year, for example, we lost 28 days. We had to close the rink.
Local business owner Angelo Marignani thinks that since the majority of residents have never skated on synthetic ice, there might be a bit of a letdown.
I applaud the city at taking an innovative step in trying to try something new to benefit the residents of Windsor. I like the idea, but maybe it's not the right fit. I would lean for real ice, real Canada, real skating.
Charles Clark Square is open from 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. on weekdays and 8 a.m. to 11 p.m. on weekends. Michelli said he hopes the community will receive it well.
We need people to come out and try it. Let us know. Let us know what their thoughts are. We've had a couple of our staff try it out yesterday just to see what their thoughts were. One was a former Windsor Spitfire, Wilf Payne, and the union president, Jim Wood. Both of them said it was a great surface to learn how to skate.
Canada's Dara Howell won gold and Kim Lamar took bronze in the women's ski slope style event at the Winter Olympics in Sochi on Tuesday. Canada now has 4 gold medals and 9 medals overall. They trail Norway, who has 11. Captain Sidney Crosby and the Canadian men's hockey team plays Norway in their first game this Thursday. CTV is making its mark on Windsor News by introducing the first local weekend newscast. Sean Preville tells us more.
When CTV Windsor moved to the old Bell Building at 1149 Goyou in November, not only did they get new digs, but also a new show.
Kara, nobody's pointing any fingers here, but I've noticed that ever since we started this, you know, local newscast together, the weather has been our top story every night.
That's Christy Bezaire hosting the weekend news. She said when she was asked by news director Dan Appleby to anchor the new show, she had no hesitation saying yes.
When he approached me with asking me, I said absolutely. This is something the community is going to want to do. They're going to want to see this. This is something that's great for our community. And I took it on right away as soon as I was asked.
Appleby said the reason for the weekend broadcast was because CTV wanted to show they were listening to their viewers.
We recognized some time ago that there was a hole, kind of a void, in local weekend coverage, and recognized that our viewers would really be better served if we could give them a local newscast.
And residents like Joanne Duffy agree.
It's really wonderful to be here in Windsor and hear about our own news as opposed to hearing about our neighbors down the 401.
When asked what's next for CTV Windsor now that the new show is up and running, Appleby said he'd like to hear from the audience.
Frankly, I'm always open to suggestions from the audience and, you know, ideas and thoughts they have about how we can better serve them.
But for now, Windsor finally has its own weekend broadcast. For MediaPlex News Now, I'm Sean Preville.
The owner of a local gay bar is saying it's time to move on, and with his leaving, so too goes his club. Reporter Sean Preville has the story.
It's hard to believe that such a full bar could become empty permanently. But after serving the LGBT community for over 4 years, the Legends of 2012 will be closing its doors this Sunday. Roger Samudio, owner of 2012, said he's closing the bar because of a new career, but will never forget the experience he's had.
I have a new career now, and it's something that I cannot say no to. You know, I have to move on with my life as well, look for different frontiers. I love meeting people, I love traveling, and in the past 4 years I only stayed in Windsor, and I do not regret it because every second that I spent with all the people that I was with here in Windsor, I loved it, and it will always stay in my mind.
While many say they are sad to see the business close, some believe the club has made its mark on the community.
I think it's going to have a real impact on the LGBT community. I mean, there are only so many places that we can go in Windsor as gay and lesbian people where we can feel that we can just be open and be ourselves. You know, I mean, you would hope that every place people would be respectful, accepting, tolerant. But you hear every so often that, you know, there are people out there that aren't, that get aggressive towards gays, lesbians, bisexual people. And so it's nice to have a place that you can go to just drop all your defenses, be who you want to be without any fear of anything happening. And to lose something like that in the community, I think that's going to hit us pretty hard.
Even with many other places for the LGBT to go to in Windsor, a place like 2012 is sure not to be forgotten. For MediaPlex News, I'm Sean Preble.
Now let's check back in with Sean, who is outside the MediaPlex, to see what kind of weather the rest of the week might bring. Sean?
Brr, I can still see my breath in the air, which means it is way too cold out here. With Valentine's Day just around the corner, you might want to skip the hearts and chocolate and buy your special someone a Snuggie. Now with your three-day weather forecast. Tomorrow we can expect -6 and sunny. Thursday will get colder, being partly cloudy and -4. And Friday to finish the week on a warm note with temperatures reaching zero with scattered flurries. That's the story from the corner of Victorian University. Back to you, Sarah.
Thanks, Sean. The first annual Doc Fest premiered last month. Joe Elliott was on hand to give us a red carpet perspective.
Now tell us a little bit about your documentary tonight.
Well, I did a documentary, it's called Bad Reputation. It's about skateboarding and more or less the no coach mentality and like the freeness behind the sport.
My documentary is on an inspiring young man named Kevin McShann. He's around here somewhere. He was born with cerebral palsy and he, despite his disability, he breaks into the journalism world and he is really good at what he does, and that's pretty much what the story was about, and I'm excited to show it to a bunch of people tonight.
My documentary is about Droulard Road and their attempt to rebrand themselves. So it's a mural project in the alleyways meant to curb crime and basically make it more of a family-friendly neighborhood than one note for crime.
Biggest diva of the MediaPlex.
Stacey Janzer.
Stacey Janzer. Oh, wow. And you only exclusively hang out with divas?
Of course. And Kyle as well. Simpkins.
The biggest diva of the MediaPlex.
Oh. Can I say myself?
You. Me?
Yes.
Well, why is that?
I've heard nothing but complaints about the temperature in the building. I've heard nothing but complaints about the software we use. I've heard nothing but complaints about the length of the mic cords. Or the condition of the equipment. This guy complains about everything.
How would you rate yourself as a director?
Spielberg wishes he could be as good as me.
Stay tuned to Kojiko in the coming weeks to view our third year's documentaries.
In this documentary, Stacey Janzer explains how Droulard Road is getting a new lease on life, and a colorful one at that.
We want people walking through the alleys, taking in the art, understanding the neighborhood at a different level, exploring the neighborhood.
Murals and art, not the first thing that comes to mind when Droulard Road is mentioned, but that's what's happening now. Droulard Road is known as an area with high criminal activity, not as a family-friendly neighborhood, but that reputation is changing. Ford City Neighborhood Renewal started up 4 years ago, and has been working with the community to change their reputation. Carlene Nielsen, community coordinator, started this process and used Walkerville's transformation as their inspiration.
Walkerville is like our sister neighborhood, right? And she's like our bigger, prettier, older sister. And we learn from what they're doing there because they had similar struggles when they first started their revitalization. Lots of vacant storefronts, you know, being associated with crime.
Ford City, also known as the Droulard Road area, was initially home to Ford Motor Company workers and their families. Until 1953, when Ford closed its plant on Riverside Drive, leaving many of the residents unemployed. Years passed, and Droulard Road became known more for crime than as a family-friendly community. Ford City Neighborhood Renewal and their community started their change by putting together community events.
We do a lot of events in order to bring people into the area so they can see it's not what they think it is. Like we do the Christmas, we do the Easter, we do Fun Day and fireworks.
That was just the beginning. Next, they used an idea started by Youth Nation just across the river. TAP, located in southwest Detroit, created a space for youth and community members to go, view, and create street art. Detroit's project spans one city block with murals on garages and other alley surfaces, and provides a legal, safe, and supportive community. Ford City was hoping the murals would have a different impact on their community.
It beautifies the area, and it just looks nice if you, like a lot of the access to the houses around in this area are through alleys, because a lot of people's driveways are in the alleys. So anyways, if your driveway's in an alley and you got to drive down the alley, it looks nice to see that instead of seeing just plain garage door or great graffiti all over them.
Graffiti still haunts the alleys along Droulard.
A lot of residents were concerned about graffiti and loitering in the alleys. So this project, by creating murals, there's a code. Artists respect other artists. Graffiti artists are still artists at the end of the day. It might not be your choice of art, but beauty's in the eye of the beholder.
Local artists were required to submit potential artwork to the resident committee. Judy DePazio was one of the local artists chosen for the project.
Well, as a local artist, I want to be involved in the community, and I really like what Ford City is doing, the renewal. Droulard Road has been bad-mouthed for many years, and I think it's about time that when artists step into a community, they make it beautiful, and it gives other people in the city another perspective of what can happen to an area when creativity becomes involved.
The murals have started the image change the residents have been looking for.
It's created an exposure about the arts community taking an interest in this neighborhood. So that's word of mouth, that's community image renewal. People talking about our project and looking at this as a project that's very unique and very positive is really big for our image across Windsor Essex. So I think it's a learning piece for a lot of people. We all know that events link neighbors to neighbors. You're building the social capital of the neighborhood. But taking that one step further now with the Alley Mural Project and actually having a physical impact on the environment of the neighborhood is really, really important.
Droulard Road residents have looked forward to the change.
The most exciting part is seeing the garages before and then after what they look like, and having just local artists, somebody that's not even big in the area, doing paintings on the garages.
This mural is being painted on Jillian Benoit's mother's home.
People have a reason to come down here and to look at it. So, you know, as he tells people, oh, I painted this house, people are going to come see, they're going to tell people, it's kind of word of mouth. And we're kind of hoping that it spreads and people see what we already have and what we're growing on.
Ford City started their journey to reconnect with the community just 4 years ago. And this project is literally changing the face of Droulard for the better. For MediaPlex News, I'm Stacey Janzer.
In this edition of Health Minute, Jolene Perrin explains how diet soda and alcohol don't mix.
A new study from Northern Kentucky University has found that using diet soda as a mixer can make you drunk at lightning speed. Researchers had volunteers drink vodka mixed with diet or regular soda and then measured their blood alcohol level and had them complete a questionnaire. The results showed those who used diet soda as a mixer were more intoxicated than people who used regular soda, even though they consumed the exact same amount of alcohol. In fact, their breathalyzer results were 18% higher. So why does diet soda make you more intoxicated? Experts say that your stomach treats regular soda like food and digests the calories, which delays the alcohol from hitting your system. But diet soda flies through your stomach and the alcohol hits your bloodstream faster, making you intoxicated quicker. In the long run, doctors say being exposed to a higher concentration of alcohol is more harmful to your health than ingesting a few more calories from soda with sugar in it. I'm Jolene Perrin, and this has been your Health Minute.
This is the time of year when many students are considering their choices for college and university. If you are considering a career in journalism, then check out this next story about what we have to offer here at the MediaPlex.
Journalism enables people to be well informed. It's documenting history. It's an extraordinary way for people to be connected with their community.
What happens in the world affects us. What happens in our community affects us. What happens in the province affects us. And we get to be the eyes and ears and tell the stories. There are many stories that need to be told, and those things add value to our life.
I'm always meeting new people. I'm learning about things that interest me, like topics that I want to learn more about.
It's neat to know that so many people are relying on me. It makes you strive for perfection, or it makes you strive for accuracy.
The journalism program here at St. Clair College is a convergence journalism program. Convergence means the merging together of print, radio, and television, and the web, and putting all different stories into three or four different platforms.
In 21st century newsrooms, journalists have to be able to do it all.
We ask every one of our reporters to tell stories in multiple ways.
There's a different style of writing for print than there is for radio, than there is for television. And it's really important that the information gets out that is true to those platforms.
We are one of the few, if not the only, program that is actually taking students to a live broadcast and giving them that opportunity and that experience.
I've gained a lot of self-confidence. I used to be a really nervous person, a really shy person, but I think this program's helped me come out of my shell. It's given me something that I love to do, and that's made me a better person.
I find that the students that come out of St. Clair College are already at or above where some of our broadcast employees have been over the last several years.
I feel that I made the greatest decision I could 2 years ago by choosing this program, because I have learned so much, and I think that I can only grow from here.
I would hands down recommend the program to someone considering it. I would recommend it to someone that's not even considering it. They teach you such a vast array of different skills, different platforms, different things that you could really apply to so many different careers.
Based on literally hundreds of interns I've seen over the years, St. Clair students are better prepared to go into the work environment in media than most students coming out of colleges and universities across North America.
I think it's that very comprehensive curriculum that we have that creates converged journalists that sets this journalism school apart.
Thanks for tuning in. I'm Sarah Ryrie. You've been watching MediaPlex News Now.
MediaPlex News Now is a production of the St. Clair College Journalism Program.